Good evening, friends. Welcome back to this revisiting series on the topic of GST in these periods of lockdown. This is the fourth of that series. As you are aware, we have been doing this since Monday and we'll be continuing this session over the next week as well. A detailed announcement will be sent to you by tomorrow on the topics and the speakers for the next week. As far as this week is concerned, we started with the details of outward supply, which we did on Monday. Thereafter, we went into the concepts of input tax credit, which we did on Tuesday.
Good evening, friends. Welcome back to this revisiting series on the topic of GST in these periods of lockdown. This is the fourth of that series. As you are aware, we have been doing this since Monday and we'll be continuing this session over the next week as well. A detailed announcement will be sent to you by tomorrow on the topics and the speakers for the next week. As far as this week is concerned, we started with the details of outward supply, which we did on Monday. Thereafter, we went into the concepts of input tax credit, which we did on Tuesday.
Good evening, friends. Welcome back to this revisiting series on the topic of GST in these periods of lockdown.
So a few instructions, basically the ritual which we always do, we request you all to keep your microphones on mute. And of course, this is something which technology will always create a problem. As we move into the details, we'll go into the specifics of the topics today. Please keep your microphones on mute. We will start in the next minute or two. As we have been doing in the past few sessions, I will first give you the presentation on the exports and the associated refund related provisions. And thereafter, I will open up the floor at around 5:30 for questions and answers. Those questions can be asked by using the chat window. Please do not use your chat window for any other purpose. Because of the larger group, we are not permitting a voice call or a voice discussion. And we have muted you all. Despite that, if it is unmuted, we request you to mute your microphone so that there is no disturbance to anyone else. With this preliminary background, we wish you a very pleasant learning and let us move into the specific questions. As I was highlighting, please use the chat window only for the purposes of question and not for any generic discussion. Otherwise, your questions can get lost within that entire series of good evenings and other messages. Friends, today what we are going to talk about is a topic which is a little bit sector specific. But at the same time, it impacts a large section of people and is more important because this results in an actual encashment of the credits or encashment of money back from the government. And basically, we are talking about exports. And as you know, it's always a stated policy of every government to not tax exports and give whatever possible benefits are available for the purposes of the said exports. While doing so, of course, the government has to keep in mind the commitments which have been given to the World Trade Organization. And we have to also ensure that the incentives given by our country do not end up in resulting in an anti-dumping duty in the other country. So that's a very tightrope walk which the government has to do at a policy level. More importantly, from the policy level, when it comes to the actual implementation, we find that there are two types of scenarios which happen. There will always be a set of people who would want to misuse this benefit, have some element of over-invoicing, and get as much benefits on cash as possible. And maybe then there will be some fly-by-night operators of that type. And because there would be a very small section of people like that, there is always an element of mistrust at the part of the government. And therefore, the government always is a bit cautious, which results in too many conditions and restrictions on the claim of refunds. And that is how this entire scenario gets a bit complicated at the legislation level. At the policy level, something which is a stated objective gets fairly diluted when you go back into the legislative level. But when it comes to the actual implementation, there are even more challenges because there is a portal related issues. Certain things portal will permit, certain things it will not permit. And it's always under GSTVC, lot of things are portal driven and automation driven. And therefore, there are certain unanswered questions around that front. If somebody gets stuck, then perhaps there is not a very clear and a quick path to really come out of that difficulties which they are facing. So that is one. Second, of course, least said the better, the bureaucratic mindset of the officers also results in a blanket denial of refunds in most of the scenarios. And therefore, all these things need to be balanced and kept into account when we are looking at this topic. And we'll try to discuss a few things around each of those issues in the various baskets which we are going to talk about. What we will be talking about today are four broad scenarios, and all of us over the last 3 years have been aware of these scenarios. One is the scenario where there is an export of goods. Again, as you know, export of goods can be on a payment of tax or against a letter of undertaking. If you have a letter of undertaking, then you claim a refund of accumulated input tax credit. In case of export of goods on payment of tax, we will say it's a scenario of an export rebate. Similarly, for services also, you have the options of rebate or LUT and an accumulated input tax credit. And thereafter, we'll also talk about various miscellaneous scenarios like your deemed exports, merchant exports, inverted duty structures, and other errors resulting in a consequential refunds. So a long list of topics to cover today, and each of them has many lanes and bylanes. So let's start straight away with the first topic, which is the export of goods. And when we talk about goods and services tax, the first hope of the industry was that essentially the difference between goods and services will get diluted. But that's not to be. And we are aware that many provisions, there are different sets of provisions for goods and services. And even when we look at the current topic, you will find that there are a separate set of regulations for goods, certain sets of separate set of regulations for services. However, at some point of time, certain provisions intermingle with each other. So what we will do is we will speak a lot about export of goods comprehensively. And when we go to export of services, we will only talk about the differences. Wherever there is a commonality, I will just give a passing reference to that. And therefore, a substantial part of my talk will be around the goods scenario. Most of it would also apply to services. So please correlate, if you are a service exporter, please correlate to my discussions in that fashion when I'm discussing about the goods. Export of goods, friends, is defined under Section 2.5 of the IGST, and it's a very simple one-liner definition. It just says export of goods, with its grammatical variations and cognate expressions, means taking goods out of India to a place outside India. A very simple definition. It says if you are a person, you are taking the goods from India to a place outside India, then it will be treated as an export of goods. Make no mistake, here we are not talking about a supply. You are not talking about a contractual relationship. You are just talking about a physical movement of goods from Indian territory to a territory outside India. And when you read this definition, you have to link it with the definition given under the Customs Act. And if you read the definition under the Customs Act, it is similarly worded, except for the fact that the Customs Act, because it deals only with goods, it is not using that phrase in the definition. It is implicit. Otherwise, if you read that definition under the Customs Act, we are told export, with its grammatical variations and cognate expressions, means taking out of India to a place outside India. And therefore, when you go to export of goods, you will find that there is a lot of correlation, lot of dependency with the customs procedures and the customs law as laid down there under. And therefore, I think it may be important that we spend a few minutes understanding the textbook type of a customs procedure which is involved for the export of goods. We will use certain terms here, and those terms will be relevant when we understand the way the rebating mechanism for export of goods has been incorporated and the checks and balances which have been kept by the government in this regard. So typically, not looking at GST in general, but since ages, since a lot of time, even in the excise regime and the earlier regime, there is a prescribed procedure when you want to export goods outside the country. We are not right now talking about the DGFT policies, wherein there could be, in certain cases, blanket prohibition from export of goods. For example, in the current scenario, there are lots of products which the country says that we need it for the Indian environment, and therefore there is a prohibition or a quota for export of certain types of goods by themselves. Now, we are not going to talk about that restrictions, but we are going to talk about assuming that your product is allowed to be exported, which most of the products are. What is the broad procedure for those exports? And I think that could primarily get divided into 5 or 6 steps. The first step, of course, would be removal of goods from your factory or from your warehouse against a proper GST invoice and a delivery challan. And when those goods reach the customs port, at that point of time, there is a requirement to file a shipping bill, which has to be filed online on the customs portal. You go to the IceGate portal using your IEC code. You log in and fill in a particular shipping bill. Now, this shipping bill is a very important document, not only from a customs perspective, but from a GST perspective as well. As we will see later, this shipping bill, in a way, becomes the starting point or the route for your entire refund claim, which you are going to claim for the export of goods. once a shipping bill is filed, thereafter the customs officer at times on a random basis is permitted to inspect the cargo, and thereafter he stamps the consignment, the shipping bill, and says that okay, I'm fine that this product can be exported. This is known as a late export order. This late export order is issued by the customs officer. Once the late export order is issued by the customs officer, only thereafter the process of loading the cargo or the containers on the vessel or the aircraft starts, and the owner of the shipping line, the cargo carrier, is given an obligation under the Customs Act to ensure that he can move the goods outside the country only after a shipping bill and a late export order has been filed. Until then, he is not permitted to move the goods outside the country. Once that happens and the movement happens, at the time when the vessel moves outside the country and crosses the Indian frontier and moves into the international territory or the high seas, the carrier is expected to file a common export manifest, which includes references for each of the shipping bills which have been carried in that vessel. So in that vessel, if there are 50 consignments which are carried, the export manifest will include the data of all the 50 consignments, including the shipping bill references. And that export manifest, which is filed online by the carrier, becomes a conclusive assurance to the government of India that the products have left the Indian territories. And this essentially is the basis for permitting a refund. And that's where when we go into the procedures of GST, you will find a lot of intermingling with each of these terms which we are using here. The shipping bill, the late export order, the export manifest, each of these terms becomes very, very important in the process of the export rebate. Important aspect which comes from the definition and from this procedure is that on an overall basis, whenever you talk about export of goods, you need to have an overseas destination. And that overseas destination must be vis-a-vis you as a person and not vis-a-vis your customer. And that is where I think a few precedents, both from the pre-GST regime and a couple of rulings from the GST regime, all of them highlight this aspect that there has to be an overseas destination coming in. There has to be a shipping bill. There has to be a customs formality which has to be completed. So, for example, if I'm supplying goods on a ship, which is known as a ship store supply, and that ship stores, the supply is made on the territorial waters of the country, even though the ship might navigate outside India and the consumption might happen outside India, there have been precedents to say that this does not constitute an export of goods, and therefore it is not eligible for any incentives which we are going to talk about today. Similarly, if you are a flight catering unit or you are supplying food on a particular vessel, what happens is whenever there's a foreign going vessel, the food is loaded at the Indian airport, and thereafter the flight will move outside the country. Now, necessarily the consumption of the food might happen outside India, but when you are supplying the goods, there is no defined destination and you have not done those customs formalities. So even supply of food on board an aircraft does not constitute export of goods, and all of these are settled propositions under the GST law. That takes me to the next aspect, and this is important again because there are lots of examples where there's an offshore activity happening outside the 12 nautical miles or within the 12 nautical miles also. Here also, since there is a destination, but the destination is not outside India, this would not be treated as an export. For example, if you are supplying some products or goods or services to ONGC or any of the oil refining companies, in that case, those transactions would not be treated as an export because the destination is within India. And as we know, India not only includes the basic landmass, but also the 12 nautical miles extending it. And thereafter, even the exclusive economic zones, which have been defined under the notifications of the government. And therefore, it's also important that the destination should be outside India. In this context, we had a very interesting matter going up in litigation, and that is regarding the duty-free shops which are there in the departure terminal of an international airport, in the international departure terminal. And there the interpretation which the courts have said is that essentially when certain products are supplied to a passenger who is on transit abroad, it is in effect a scenario of an export and there is a sufficient customs documentation. And therefore, there are a couple of high court rulings which says that when the products are given to those types of people for taking them outside India, in that scenario, the export benefit should be allowed. So this is one interesting exception which has recently come up from a Bombay High Court decision and an Allahabad High Court decision. But except this example, in most of the other examples, we would say that there has to be a proper shipping bill and you need to have a defined overseas destination if you have to treat something to be an export of goods. Another aspect which comes out from the definition of export is taking of goods out of India to a place outside India. And therefore, it covers your actual taking. It does not cover a scenario of a constructive taking or causing of a taking. In that sense, what we bring about as a principle is that under the GST law, only the direct exporter of goods is covered under the concept of exports. Penultimate exporters are not covered. If you are supplying to someone who in turn is going to supply abroad, that is not to be treated as an export. That may fit within certain other concessions, which we will speak in a couple of minutes, but it will not fall within the generic basket of export of goods or export of services also for that matter. Now, in that context, what we are told is supplies to SEZs should also be given a similar treatment like exports. And therefore, as a policy under Section 16, even supplies to SEZs are zero rated. They are separately covered. Though most of the provisions are similar to direct exports, one or two nuances are there, which we will talk about when we go into those specific sections. But again, in general, supply to SEZ is not an export, but it is also zero rated. Now, these terms will become important. Zero rated supply is an umbrella term. Within that, you have two sub umbrellas. One is the direct exports and another is supplies to SEZs. Now, as far as supplies to EOUs is concerned, it is not direct export. It is not even a zero rated supply. It is only defined as a deemed export through one of the notifications. And because it is defined as a deemed export, there's a separate type of a treatment. And it's a very, very different treatment as compared to zero rating. And therefore, one will have to be very careful about whether one wants to go into that option of deemed export or not. And there is an option given both to either to the supplier or to the recipient to get back the money as a refund from the government. And we'll talk about it. It's a very, very different from the general mechanism of direct exports. And that takes me to the last variation which I would bring about. And that results to that is relating to supplies which are made by merchant exporters. And as you are aware, pre-GST, there was something known as CT1 and there was also something known as H-form. Both these documents are not there under the GST law, and penultimate transactions by no stretch of imaginations amount to export of goods. When GST law was introduced, there was really nothing for such type of penultimate transactions. And that resulted in a lot of cash flow issue. And in the first few months, the portals were also not geared up to give back the refund to the exporters. And therefore, somewhere in October, the government came out with a concessional scheme through a notification saying that if I am selling to an exporter who is going to further trade, manufacturers will not get covered. But if I'm selling to a trader who is then going to export those goods outside the country, then there is a merchant export benefit by way of a lower rate of tax, which is 0.1% tax of 0.1% of the value. Now, that of course is subject to various conditions. And one important condition is that effectively the goods have to leave the country within 3 months from your original date. And there's a lot of documentation and other things involved in that. And one has to be careful that those documentation is correctly satisfied. So that has come in when we talk about merchant exporters. So these are the special cases which are available. Now, right now we will be concentrating primarily on export of goods. And when we talk about export of goods, please note that we are only talking about direct exports of goods, not about supplies to SEZs, EOUs, or merchant trades, which are deemed exports or penultimate transactions. We are only talking about direct export of goods. And those direct export of goods, as you know, are defined under Section 16 to be zero rated supplies. As a policy decision, we say that a taxpayer can export a goods or make a zero rated supply either on payment of tax and claim a subsequent refund, or he can export without payment of tax against a bond or a letter of undertaking. So these are the two routes which are there. I make a payment of tax and then I file a rebate claim or the refund claim. For simplicity, I will use the word rebate so that we are clearly distinguishing between this route and the other route. So in the first route, you pay tax. And why would somebody want to pay tax? The answer to that is very simple. In most of the cases, you have accumulated input credits. So a substantial portion of your output tax would be paid, or maybe even full output tax might be paid from your input tax credit. And therefore, you are really not paying it. You are paying it from the notional asset which you have. And thereafter, you file a rebate claim of the output tax so paid, and then you get that money back by way of cash direct credit into your bank account. And this is notified under Rule 96, which, of course, as I was highlighting in the earlier slide, there's a lot of integration with the customs authorities. And therefore, this route we will talk about as a customs route, and we'll understand in detail in the next slide how this entire customs route works. To a very large extent, this route has been automated. And therefore, there's very little of human interference which is involved in this process. If everything is done in the correct spirit and the correct manner, the refund automatically comes within a few days. As compared to that, we have a second option wherein the zero-rated supply, that is the export of goods, can be made without any upfront payment of tax against a bond or a letter of undertaking. Now, under a bond or a letter of undertaking, you typically undertake that you will export your goods or services, and certain other conditions are laid down under that. Now, when you export without payment of any tax, that's not the end of it, because at the procurement stage, you might have procured the various inputs, input services, etc. And all of that you would have paid taxes on, which you would have claimed input tax credit. Now, there you have two scenarios. If you are a mixed exporter, you also have a lot of domestic activities. The law permits you to adjust that input tax credit of exports against the other domestic output taxes. And if your domestic output is large enough and you have only a little bit of exports, you might end at that. You may not want to go ahead. You have not paid tax on exports, and that's the end of it. Whatever benefit of inputs gets automatically adjusted against the domestic output tax. But if you have substantial exports, or the value addition in your entire field is not very high, you might have accumulated input tax credit after adjusting your domestic output tax. In that scenario, under this option, the government tells you that you can file a refund claim of such accumulated input tax credit. And for that, there's a different rule or a different mechanism which is prescribed in the Rule 89. And that typically takes you to the GST officers. And therefore, we will say this is the GST route. To summarize, when you're looking at export of goods, there are two distinct alternative routes, and you have to choose one of them upfront. One is you export on payment of tax and use the customs route to get the rebate back, or you export against a bond or an LUT and you choose the GST route under a Rule 89 and claim the refund of accumulated input tax credit. Friends, make no mistake, both these routes are clearly distinct and alternative to each other. And this choice has to be made before you ship the goods outside the country. In fact, when you file a shipping bill, there is a very specific column which has to be flagged that whether you are choosing option one or option two, which I have been talked about over here. And thereafter, if you want to switch in between, it's a very complicated scenario. You are not permitted to switch in between. What typically at times happens is, while the intention is to choose option one, the partial conduct is on option one, partial conduct is on option two. Now, if documentation is not done correctly, we have seen people run helter-skelter, and there's no person who will guide them correctly. And then they keep on blaming, saying that, look, we are stuck and the government is not able to resolve. So therefore, a lot of care is required on this front, that everything is thought through at the time of pre-exportation, before exportation, and each documentation is done in the correct manner so that you do not trip somewhere in between and get stuck into a scenario where you do not have any way to move out or to resolve that problem which you are stuck with. So let's now look at the first option, export on payment of tax and subsequent rebate or refund. And broadly, as I was explaining in the earlier discussion, the concept is, as an exporter, you might have various inputs. You take the input tax credit under Section 16(2). You export on payment of IGST. When you export on payment of IGST, for paying that output IGST, you will utilize the input tax credit which you have claimed. Maybe a little bit of value addition, you might need to pay extra tax. You will pay that much from your electronic cash ledger also. And once that payment is made, you then go ahead and claim a refund of IGST. And for this purpose, the shipping bill is deemed to be considered as your application for refund. So it's a very simplistic type of a structure which we are bringing in. And if we comply with this correctly, the entire mechanism of getting the rebate is much more simplistic and easy to follow. However, when you're looking at this provision, there are certain scenarios where the government says, I do not want to give you the rebate. And there are three important scenarios which has been talked about in Rule 96, sub-Rule 10. And when you look at those scenarios, a couple of retrospective amendments had come. And all of these amendments and changes have come because of various scenarios where the assessee tries to obtain a double benefit. Let me go back to this slide and explain you the concept. The government says that if you are buying inputs wherein there's an input tax credit of 80, on sales there is an output tax of 100, you will use that 80, pay the balance 20 from your own pocket. So 100 rupees is totally paid as a tax, and then you will file a rebate claim of 100 and get back that 100. Now up to that, it's fine. There's also a section 54.3, which says that if you claim this rebate of output tax of 100 rupees on the same transaction, you cannot go back and claim the input tax credit of 80 rupees. Now somebody will say, how can you do both of them? Now friends, you could be a mixed exporter and maybe you have a transition credit or an old credit which is already there in your books. So therefore, section 54.3 clearly says that you can't do both the things together. You can't claim that 80 rupees back by way of a refund of ITC and 100 also as a rebate of output tax. So far so good. But another possibility which people can do is they can procure against a concessional rate, and therefore for this transaction your input credit is only 10, and yet you will use the 100 rupees and you will not claim this 10 rupees, but basically that the balance 90 rupees you are monetizing your accumulated credit, and therefore this type of double benefit the government doesn't want to give. So what it says is, if your procurement is under any of these three notifications where you are permitted to purchase goods without payment of tax or at a very concessional rate of tax, in that case, you cannot claim the rebate under the rebating provisions under Rule 96. So the first example is, if you are an export-oriented undertaking and you procure your inputs or capital goods or your input services under Notification 48 of 2017. Now, this is the notification which permits a domestic supplier to provide us a product to an EOU against as a deemed export benefit, and he may collect the tax and claim a refund. And therefore, effectively, there is no tax in these types of transactions. Similarly, the penalty made exports, the 0.1% facility is available under Notification 40. So if you are claiming that benefit, then again, the government says you cannot really again claim the rebate on the same thing. Same way, Notification 78, EOUs are permitted to import duty-free, not pay basic custom duty or IGST CVD. And in those cases also, the government says that I do not want to give you the benefit of the output duty rebate. Now, of course, as I was highlighting, the objective in all these examples was to avoid grant of double benefit. Now, when you look at the import by the EOUs, typically those imports, one might take an exemption of the basic custom duty, but may not take an exemption for IGST because that is creditable. Now, in those types of scenarios, there was a bit of a disconnect that essentially the EOU was losing the entire benefit. And therefore, very recently, from 22nd of March onwards, there has been an explanation which has been inserted, which says that if you are claiming only the basic custom duty benefit, but not claiming the IGST benefit under Notification 78, in that case, you will be eligible for an export rebate. And this definitely is a welcome amendment which has been brought in very recently in the context of exporters of goods who are especially located in EOUs or STPs or EHTPs, etc. So that, I think, summarizes cases where you are not eligible for claiming an export rebate. When you file a shipping bill, you are going to put a declaration which says that you are not governed by these scenarios, and therefore that self-declaration will become very, very important at a later point of time if these conditions are not satisfied. Now, assuming you are eligible, what is the procedure for the rebate? And that's where the government says, I have to look at it from a three-way match. The first important aspect is that the goods have to leave the country, which we will know from the customs documentation, which is your filing of shipping bill, etc. The exporter should make a claim, and that claim can be made only when that invoice is uploaded by the exporter in his GST return. So therefore, uploading in the details of outward supplies in GSTR1 becomes very important. And at the same time, because you are getting a rebate of an output tax which has been paid, it is important that this tax be paid and your electronic cash or credit ledger be debited and an offset be done, and therefore filing of return and disclosure in GSTR 3B. So there are three levels of matches which are important. Firstly, the data has to correctly flow in the customs documentation. Secondly, the data has to correctly flow in the GSTR 1. And thirdly, the payment of tax has to be correctly reflected in your GSTR 3B. And only when all these three will match, that a green tick happens, and thereafter the refund is processed by the customs EDI customs authorities, and the payment comes into your bank account, which has been mentioned with the customs authorities. We'll go into each of them in a little bit more detail in the subsequent slides, but the process is broadly like this, and this is the flow chart which one may be keeping in mind. And because of this entire procedure, what you find is that there are two different agencies involved in this process. One is the GST authorities and another is the customs authorities. And therefore, as a taxpayer, it becomes very important for you to make sure that you are complying with all the conditions and the procedures in the correct manner. Because if there's any disconnect, it is very easy for the customs authorities to say you go to the GST authorities, and for the GST authorities to redirect you to the customs authorities. And this is what practically happens. And the taxpayer then just keeps on running from pillar to post, from one table to another table, and without getting any resolution to his challenges. Of course, the government also had a lot of refund camps. They did a lot of circulars and clarified a lot of concessions and things like that. But essentially, this is the root cause of a lot of mess. Some mess has got resolved, but some mess still continues on this entire rebating procedure. So let's now therefore go into the nitty-gritties and understand what all care is required in each of these three documentation. The first care which has to be taken is at the customs level, and the main important care at that level is to make sure that in the shipping bill, the on payment option is flagged. Therefore, if here you are said on letter of undertaking, and later on in your rebate, in your GSTR 1, you end up paying a tax, disclosing it as a tax payable. In 3B also, you show that as a tax paid. All of that will not help. The first starting point is the shipping bill has to be correctly done. Now, in most of the organizations, the shipping bill is filed by the custom house agent. Of course, therefore, it's important that that custom house agent has a very clear instruction from you, and he does the things correctly when he files the shipping bill on your behalf. So therefore, that is the first important care which has to be taken. Second is your GST number should be correctly quoted. And when I say your GST number should be correctly quoted, please note that a exporter might have more than one GST numbers because he might be registered in more than one state. So if your shipping bill has a GST number, your GST number of Maharashtra, but you upload it in your GSTR 1 and 3B of Gujarat, that again is going to be a mismatch, and it is not going to get processed, and your rebate will get stuck. And therefore, your GST number of the exporter, the correct exporter who is going to raise the tax invoice and who is going to disclose it in your GSTR 1 and 3B, that same GST number should be mentioned. As I was highlighting, after all the shipping bills are done, the late export orders are done, and the goods are loaded and taken outside the territorial waters, the carrier is expected to file an export general manifest. And that export general manifest has to have a very clear reference to your shipping bill which you have filed. Now, if that linkage is not there, it again throws an error, a mismatch report, and thereafter you have to chase the carrier and make sure that in his export general manifest, there is an amendment done and the correct shipping bill number is identified by the carrier and put in that area. And finally, you don't want your money to go into somebody else's bank account, and therefore in your shipping bill and the customs documentation, as well as the GST records, your correct bank account details where you want your money to flow in should be mentioned so that the money can flow into that respective bank account. So that is the initial care which you have to take prior to the transaction. Now, when it comes to filing your GSTR 1, few things become very important. In the GSTR 1, there's a very specific table which talks about zero rated supplies, export of goods on payment of tax. Now, in that table, each of the columns you have to match exactly as per the shipping bills. And that becomes very, very important. Even if there's a small variation in the details, you will find that there's a mismatch and the rebate will not get processed. You will then have to go through the GSTR 1 amendment route and try to amend that erroneous data. So therefore, be very careful in replicating exactly the way your shipping bill is in the GSTR 1. So right from your invoice number, invoice date, port code should be exactly as per the shipping bill. the shipping bill number and the shipping bill date should be also similar. Invoice value, let there be a foreign exchange variation. Don't go worry too much about it. As far as GST R1 is concerned, take the value as per the shipping bill. And of course, thereafter, you will have, when you do your GST audit, you will have a foreign exchange reconciliation, realization versus booking reconciliation, which can come, and it can come in the reconciliation statement over there. The GST payment, you have to tick with payment of tax. That is very important. The taxable amount should match, and even the IGST amount should match. Even a variation of paises will create a problem, rupees and paise. So you have to be very careful about this aspect of uploading the data in your GST R1. Then comes GST R3B, because GST R1 you file on 11th. Thereafter on 20th, you end up filing GST R3B. And in GST R3B, there are two columns, as you are aware, where you have to disclose the tax liabilities. The subcolumn A of table 3.1 talks about outward taxable supplies other than zero rated, nil rated, and exempted supplies. And column B talks about outward taxable supplies which are zero rated. Now, it is very important that the exports which you are wanting to claim a rebate on is disclosed in column B and not in column A. In many cases, we found that the SSEs by mistake put it in table A, and then the government has no mechanism to know that you have paid the tax on exports, because A does not cover exports. It's only column B which covers exports. And thereafter, it becomes a difficulty, and there's a cumulative count which is maintained by the portal to make sure that your GST R1 and 3B, the cumulative totals match, and only to the extent of 3B totals or the lower of the 3B totals and GST R1 totals, subject to the matching with the shipping bill, that you get a credit or the rebate. And therefore, the three-way match becomes very, very important. Now, when the rebate claims are being processed, the portal has also defined certain codes or error codes which will define and guide you if there is if your rebate is stuck at any reason or for whatsoever reason. So of course, the SB002 is a successful code, which means the rebate has been processed and ideally it should reach your bank account. If it has not reached your bank account, it means that you have given a wrong bank account details, and this is something which you should be really worried about and immediately identify what is the reason for that. SB001 error would typically mean that it's an invalid shipping bill detail. 002 basically means the export general manifest is not filed by the carrier. In that scenario, you have to go to your shipping line, maybe through whichever freight forwarding agency you have contracted for the freight. Please approach them, approach the shipping line and check out why they have not filed the export general manifest. Or if it has been filed, your transaction has not reflected therein. Thereafter, next is the invalid GSTIN ID. If that be the case, you might need to rectify and file a correct return and then take care of it. Next error is relating to duplication. If you have already filed one return and then another return, you are going to put the same information, they are going to say a duplication error. Next is an invoice number mismatch, SB005. Next one is a gateway EGM, where there are feeder lines which take you into a master line. In that case, gateway EGM details not available. Next one is the return month mismatch. Thereafter, there is a port code mismatch which also comes in. So these are some commonplace errors which might be there. And if you are facing any of these errors, you will have to go into those specific mechanism, find out a solution to that, do the necessary rectification, change the respective parties, and thereafter only your rebate will get processed. Now, friends, when we looked at the basic definition of export of goods, we said that the export of goods is a very simplistic one-liner sentence which says taking of goods outside of India to a place outside, out of India to a place outside India. And there is nothing which talks about foreign currency. Unlike export of service, which we will speak about in a few minutes, you will find that export of goods, there is no requirement to realize the money in convertible foreign exchange. And somewhere the government was not very comfortable with that approach. And therefore, very recently, the government has introduced a rule 96B. For export of services, realization in foreign currency was required. For goods, there was still today no such condition. But now, rule 96B brings in that condition. It says, the day you export, I'm giving you the rebate. But you should realize the money within reasonable time, the reasonable time prescribed by RBI. If you do not get the money within that time, and of course, RBI is liberal, it also permits you to apply for extension of time. If you apply for extension, then they say you should realize it within the extended time frame. And they say, if you don't realize within that time, the rebate which has been given to you will be recovered along with interest. And later on, maybe after, so generally the RBI time limit is 1 year. and thereafter you can apply for extension. So let's say assume you have not applied for extension and you have not realized the money within 1 year. In that case, the government says the rebate which you took for this export of goods, you have to give back the rebate to me with interest. And maybe after 2.5-3 years, if you really get back the money, at that point of time, you can again claim a rebate on the basis of actual realization. Now, in this type of a COVID scenario, where we see lots of clients and internationally, there's a lot of pressure on collections and other areas and businesses. You might find scenarios where you might end up in not realizing your convertible foreign exchange within a period of 1 year. And therefore, this rule 96B, one will have to be very careful about. Now, when I'm talking about this rule 96B, the first recourse, of course, as I was highlighting, was that you should apply to RBI for an extension. Anyways, the FEMA provisions require you to do that. So please do not make a mistake. Please apply for an extension. Moment you make an application for an extension, you can say that you are hopeful of getting an extension. And therefore, you wait till RBI either grants an extension or expressly rejects your extension. Our experience is RBI generally does not reject an extension. It's deemed to be granted. And therefore, if you are vigilant enough to make sure that you apply for an extension within the timeline, this rule should not really create too much difficulty for you. But that is a very important proposition which you need to bear in mind. However, in legal fraternity, we always question whether there can be such a rule at all, especially because the provisions of the law, the section does not at any place require that for an export, something should be realized in convertible foreign exchange. But that is something for some another day at a litigation forum. The primary advice right now would be that if you are not likely to realize the money within the time frame prescribed under the RBI, please apply for extension. That would be the suggestion at this level. So friends, that is as far as export of goods against rebate is concerned. We now go to the second option wherein you do not end up paying a tax on the output side. You choose to claim the benefit of the upfront exemption from payment of tax. At the same time, you want an input tax credit refund. Now in those scenario, the first important thing which you need to bear in mind is you should have what is known as a letter of undertaking or a bond. Now that letter of undertaking or a bond has to be applied online for each registered person for each financial year. In view of the COVID situation, there has been a relaxation. So we are told that if you had applied for LUT for financial year 19-20, that will be valid till 30th June. Otherwise, every start of the financial year, you are required to renew your letter of undertaking. Now, what essentially does this letter of undertaking say? It's as a process, it's a very simple process. It's an online documentation which you have to fill along with a corporate two witnesses to be attached, details of two witnesses to be submitted over there. And once the application is made, the application receipt number, the ARN number itself is deemed to be the LUT number, and therefore it's deemed to be approved in general cases. What that LUT typically says is you undertake to pay the tax along with interest if goods are not exported within 3 months from the date of issue of invoice. Now, this is important. Please understand, typically you will issue an invoice when the goods move from your factory. And there's always some timeline between the exit of the goods from the factory till the date of actual export, which is defined as the net export order and the physical movement of the goods outside the country. Now, typically in these types of lockdown situations, you might end up in a scenario that it might get extended by a month or 2 months. And therefore, you will have to be very careful to make sure that your goods are actually physically exported within a period of 3 months from the date of the tax invoice which has been raised. Otherwise, there will be an exposure towards the payment of tax along with interest if the export does not happen within a period of 3 months. Now, against an LUT, as I was highlighting, there's an upfront exemption from payment of output tax. At the same time, you will get a refund of accumulated input tax credit. Now, that itself has been defined. We are told refund amount will be the turnover of zero rated supply of goods plus the turnover of zero rated supply of services multiplied by the net ITC divided by the adjusted total turnover. So what you do is your refund eligibility is based on the ratio of your export to your total turnover, and your total turnover include export as well as domestic, multiplied by the net ITC. Now each of these terms is defined, and those terms have certain ramifications when we go to the actual refund processing. The turnover of zero rated supply of goods is meant to be the value of zero rated supply of goods made during the relevant period. Generally a month, there are exceptions to that, but right now we'll say a particular month. So whatever be the value of the zero rated supply, that is the turnover of zero rated supply which you will put over here. However, recently there's one more cap which has been brought in. We are told or the value which is 1.5 times the value of like goods domestically supplied, whichever is lower. Now this essentially has come in because somewhere the government found a few cases where some people exported goods against over invoicing and tried to get more benefits on account of refunds. And therefore the government says that if you are selling a product domestically for 100 rupees, then for the purposes of export benefit, the same product, similar type of a product, I will not allow you the export benefit for an output value above 150. I think to a large extent it is theoretical, but if you are trying to plan something around it, in specific cases, there might be an implication coming in, then there might be a lower amount of refund which might come in. This italic portion has been recently introduced, and therefore if you are into this business and you feel that you are covered within this, you please go back and look at your actual numbers. And if required, then maybe email it to us and we can discuss it offline on this aspect of this amendment which has come in. The second aspect which comes is the definition of net ITC. The ITC which is eligible for refund, we are told the net ITC means input tax credit availed on inputs and input services during the relevant period. And relevant period means the period for which the claim has been filed. And when you look at both these definitions together, what you find is typically, you are not eligible for claiming a refund of accumulated input tax credit on account of capital goods. It's only inputs and input services where you are eligible for a refund in case of export of goods or services. You are not eligible to claim the accumulated ITC refund on account of capital goods. So that is the first aspect which creates a little bit of a hindrance. And the second hindrance comes because the definition of net input tax credit says it includes availed on inputs and input services during the relevant period. And therefore, if you have an opening balance of input tax credit, that opening balance of input tax credit does not enter into this formula. And therefore, you are not eligible to get back the refund of your opening balance. And this therefore may result in timing mismatches. A very simplistic example which I can give of a timing mismatch is a person who is an exporter. He buys the raw materials in month one. He keeps on manufacturing in month one, and therefore he gets all the ITC in month one. Thereafter, he exports these goods in the month two. Because the ITC becomes an opening balance, it does not go into the net ITC formula which we are talking about over here. And despite those very goods going in the exports, he is not eligible to claim the refund. And this was in the initial months a larger issue. And therefore, later on, the government gave a clarification to say that a relevant period in my year means the period for which the claim has been filed, which means that you can file a cumulative refund claim for more than 1 month. If you are envisaging this scenario, file a cumulative refund claims for months 1 and 2. And when you do that cumulative refund claims for month 1 and 2, this issue will get resolved. To some extent, it does get resolved, but in many cases, it may not get resolved. Also, we need to understand that the portal does not permit you to file a refund claim for month 3 until you have filed a refund claim for month 2. And therefore, you have to be a little bit careful if you are having this type of dynamic scenarios. Also, one important provision which you need to bear in mind is Section 54 Proviso, which says that if you have claimed the drawback of central tax, then you are not eligible to claim the refund of accumulated input tax credit, because again, a drawback and input tax credit will result in a double benefit. There have been clarifications which said that the rebate of the state level taxes can still be claimed. The lower drawback can be claimed. All those options are available. The whole idea is that you should not get a double benefit. And in that context, there have been scenarios where somebody had by error claimed a drawback of central tax and therefore his refund of ITC got denied. And courts have said that, okay, if at a later point of time, this person is ready to give back his drawback, then please give him the refund. But let's avoid those types of scenarios. Let's think through these examples beforehand and accordingly take a call on each of these things and take only one of them and not both of them. There's a long process step as far as the ITC refund application is concerned. It starts with the filing of a refund application on the portal in RFD01A, which also has various schedules and submissions right from the computation of the refund amount. And once you file the details online thereafter, you also are required to manually submit the documents, and they are recently they have said that online submission of documents will be sufficient. However, there are certain size restraints for online submission of documents. So essentially, we find that we end up with submitting that entire manual set of documents to the respective jurisdictional officer. Please note here, you are filing the refund application to the respective GST officer and not to the customs officer. The GST officer then undertakes an initial scrutiny of documents. If there's some prima facie defect, he will issue a deficiency memo. Otherwise, he will grant you a provisional refund. Friends, under the law, there's a requirement to grant you a 90% refund within a period of 1 week. So he'll grant you that 90% refund. And thereafter, he will undertake a detailed scrutiny of all your documents. And thereafter, grant a final refund of the balance 10%. So this is the broad refund process. It's, as you can see, a very, very elaborate process as compared to the rebating process. But well, in many cases, if your rebating option is ruled out for you, then there's no other option but to go under the unutilized ITC refund mechanism. When you're in the ITC refund mechanism, you also have to understand the dynamics of the ITC refund mechanism with the electronic credit ledger under the GSTR-3B. You are told that when you file a refund application, you have to debit that much amount from your electronic credit ledger, and therefore your balance of ECR gets reduced at the time of making the application. You still not got the money, but yet the balance gets reduced. And later on, if the officer rejects that refund application, then the amount is recredited into your ECR ledger through a specific order passed by the officer. And therefore, in this scenario, if the officer sleeps over your refund application or issues a deficiency notice which you are unable to comply with immediately, you will find that you have lost your balance in your ECR balance, as well as you have still not got the actual cash in your hand. And therefore, that's a little bit of a tricky proposition which comes up over here in case of ECR transactions and ITC refund going together. Here also, the Rule 96B, which has been recently amended under the rebating context, similar amendment is there over here for ITC refund also. So you are told that whatever refund you have received, if you don't realize the money in convertible foreign exchange within the RBI prescribed time frame, then you will be required to refund back that ITC refund which you got along with interest. And you can again claim it back when you actually realize the currency, foreign currency from the foreign party. So friends, that takes me to the next aspect, which deals with export of services. In the preamble, I had highlighted that quite a few provisions are similar, and therefore my concentration on discussion for export of services will be only in areas where there's a disconnect between the provisions for export of goods and export of services. Now, the phasic disconnect at the starting point is the definition of services, export of service itself. We had a very simple one-line definition for export of goods. As compared to that, for export of services, we have a very elaborate definition which requires satisfaction of 5 cumulative tests. Then the very reason for this is export of service as a concept itself is intangible, and therefore there's no other authority like a customs authority which will verify the correctness of the claim. And therefore, export of service is more contractual, more transactional, rather than more physical. And when you look at those 5 conditions, what are those 5 conditions? We are told that the supplier should be located in India, which is true, you are in India. We are told that the recipient should be located outside India. The third condition is the most important condition, which says that the place of supply of service is located outside India. As you know, generally, the place of supply of service is the location of the recipient of service. However, there are various exceptions like immovable property basket. You have the intermediary service, and this intermediary service is a big controversial service because department interprets it to be very, very wide, whereas the actual interpretation of that intermediary service is not that wide, but reasonably narrow. So that litigation and that risk arises because of this subclause 3 being there and that interpretation of intermediary. We have seen many cases, officers issuing deficiency memos saying that according to me, the place of supply of service is in India, and therefore you are not eligible for accumulated ITC refund. The next condition is that the payment should be received in convertible foreign exchange. So here, unlike export of goods, your receipt in convertible foreign exchange is one of the most important criteria to treat something as an export of service. And finally, we are told that they are not two distinct branches of the same legal entity. So these are the cumulative conditions which have to be satisfied before you can treat something as an export of service. Now, again, as far as export of service is concerned, you have 2 options. That export of service also is a zero-rated supply. So the same 2 options which we talked about for export of goods are applicable for export of services as well. You can export on payment of tax and file a rebate claim. However, because here the customs authority is not involved, the rebate claim also will be filed in Rule 96, read with Rule 89, and the procedures will be as per Rule 89. You will still have to knock the doors of the GST officer and not the customs officer. And therefore, to some extent, it really becomes really redundant whether you are going into the rebate option or the accumulated ITC option for the export of services. As far as accumulated ITC option is concerned, again, the same Rule 89 option is available to you. Now, when you are going under the rebating option, let's revisit some of the points which we discussed in export of goods. If you recollect, in export of goods, we had said that SSEs who are governed by Rule 9610, which is basically EOUs or persons who are buying under that 0.1% option or buying under the deemed export benefits, those would be ineligible for the rebate for export of goods. Similar ineligibility test also applies to export of services also. In export of goods, we said that the shipping bill will be the application. Here you have to file a separate application for rebate, which will be the RFD-01A. And that will be filed, and that will be filed before your on the GST portal to your GST officer. Friends, please understand that the rebate under the export of service will be available only after you receive the money in convertible foreign exchange. And therefore, FIRC is the key on the basis of which the rebate will be actuated or given to you. Merely raising of invoice is not sufficient. You will have to wait till you get the money in foreign currency and then only file the rebate application. And because you are filing after getting the foreign currency, therefore Rule 96B has no relevance as far as export of service is concerned. And that's not required at all because rebate is available only post realization in convertible foreign exchange. Therefore, you never got a rebate in another scenario. So there's no question of recovery of that rebate wrongly given to you. So friends, these are some points which we need to bear in mind. Otherwise, conceptually, export of service under rebate is similar to export of service under the export of goods under the rebate mechanism. Now we go to the claim of refund of accumulated ITC, which is under Rule 89. Here also, the formula of refund amount remains the same. But here, we need to look at the definition of turnover of zero-rated supply of services. And when you look at that, what we are told is only while you will otherwise look at your aggregate turnover, for the purposes of zero-rated supplies, which is your export of services, you will look at the value on the basis of receipts. And therefore, you are told the value means the aggregate of payments received during the relevant period, payments received during the relevant period, where the supply has been completed and the payment has been received in advance for a prior period. So all those cases only will become a part of your eligibility for the claim of refund. And accordingly, the adjusted total turnover also has been suitably amended. Make no mistake, in your total turnover, domestic services will be on billing basis. All your supplies of goods, whether they be domestic or exports, will be on the basis of billing basis. But export of service will be considered both in the numerator as well as the denominator on the receipt basis calculations. As far as net ITC is concerned, the issue remains the same. Capital goods is not included in this. Opening balance has not been included within the definition of net ITC. And therefore, those challenges continue to exist even in case of accumulated ITC refund claim for export of services. With that, we go on to miscellaneous scenarios of refunds. We have talked reasonably in detail about the export of goods and export of services. I will take 5 more minutes to discuss the other refund scenarios, and thereafter we will open up the floor for questions from you, if any. Going into the other refund scenarios, as far as supplies to SEZs are concerned, Section 16 treats them also as zero-rated supplies, and therefore even for supplies to SEZs, both the options of rebate as well as accumulated ITC is available. However, one important aspect which we need to bear in mind is, if you are going under the rebate option, the rebate will be given to you subject to the principle of unjust enrichment. Now, this is important. If you are exporting goods or services, you can actually collect the tax from the foreign party if he gives you and yet get the money back from the government. Unjust enrichment does not apply to export of goods or services. However, it does apply to supplies to SEZ for the simple reason that it is possible that the SEZ can also claim the benefit. It is still under the Indian territory. It is still registered under GST. So it might claim credits or it might claim accumulated refunds and so on. And therefore, for the rebating option, the entire rebate option for supplies to SEZ is made subject to the principles of unjust enrichment. That takes me to other than zero-rated supplies. And that first thing which we will talk about is deemed exports, which is against advance authorization or an EOU. Now in this, there's a specific notification dealing with examples of deemed exports. And in those deemed exports, make no mistake, you are first required to pay the tax. Here an upfront exemption is not available to the supplier. However, what you are told is, once you have supplied to an EOU after charging a tax, you can either claim the refund yourself or the recipient can file a refund claim. And accordingly, disclaimer certificates can be given by the supplier to the recipient or by the recipient to the supplier. And there's a very detailed procedure which has been laid down for this entire process to be done. Similarly, Rule 89.5 deals with domestic scenarios of inverted duty structure, wherein we are told that if you have input which is at a much higher rate of tax and your output tax rate is lower, in that case, if you have an accumulated input tax credit on account of such inverted duty structure, you can file for a refund claim under 89.5. Now, friends, here the refund is available only for inputs and not for input services. And this, of course, has been a little bit of a subject matter of litigation. But if your input tax rate is higher than your output tax rate, then only you get the refund. And input service does not enter the formula of net input tax credit, resulting in a very minimal amount of refund available under the calculations under this mechanism. Friends, these were scenarios of credit balance in your credit ledger, which you wanted a refund. But if you have a balance in your electronic cash ledger, that balance can be any time claimed a refund, and there is no condition, no specific provision which says that these are the situations when you will get it. You will always get any balance which is available in your electronic cash ledger back by way of a refund. There's only a simple application which you have to file at any point of time. Now this becomes important, especially in companies which have government clients, and governments might end up deducting TDS. And when you accept that TDS gets reflected into your electronic cash ledger. Now, if your output tax liability net of input tax credit is not very large, you might file for a refund application for this TDS, which has ultimately culminated into your electronic cash ledger. Or by mistake, if you have paid more electronic cash, more amount in your electronic cash ledger, you can claim it back at any point of time that you want. A commonplace question which comes up is, I have made an excess payment of tax in a particular month, which means I disclosed an extra tax liability, which then what was to be disclosed. The government guidance is that you can adjust it in a subsequent 3B. So for example, in a particular month, let's say April, you had a turnover of 100, and instead of 100, you disclosed a tax of 1000. So you paid that also. Now you realize that you have by mistake paid this excess tax of 1000. So that minus 900, which is the extra, the government says that in the month of May, you can adjust that 900 in the subsequent 3B. But the problem which arises is the 3B does not permit you to put in negative figure. So if in May you have 1200 tax payable, you can adjust this minus 900 and pay only 300. Life is easy. But if you in the next month, you do not have any tax, or you are in the closure of your business and you are unlikely to have that tax, the 3B does not permit you to show this minus 900. In these types of scenarios, you will have to file a subsequent refund claim. Similarly, you have supplied goods, you have paid the tax, thereafter there is a goods rejection. You are allowed to do a credit note, and that credit note, as we had discussed in an earlier session, you can do that up to the September of the next year. Now, if there's a delayed credit note and you have forgot to disclose it in the period of in the return period up to September of next year, then you can file a separate refund claim saying that, look, the underlying supply never happened, and therefore you can file a separate refund claim. One very common challenge which we many times see is, because the tax is in various columns, cash ledger is into three columns, CGST, SGST, IGST, and thereafter you also have a code for late fees and interest and penalties. If at the time of making the payment through a challan, you wrongly select a CGST instead of IGST, or the other way around, you then get stuck up. And therefore, in those types of scenarios, based on the government representation, just last week, the portal has now been validated. And if you have a balance in CGST cash ledger and you want to use it for paying taxes on the SGST account, what you can do is, you can, there's a separate type of a document called PMT9. You can file that document, and using that document, you can transfer the balance from CGST cash ledger to SGST cash ledger, and then use that SGST cash ledger balance to pay the SGST output tax. So that bridge has been created, but please note that bridge is created only for balances in cash ledger. There is no such bridge available for balances in credit ledger. If you have an amount stuck in a credit ledger, that amount gets stuck unless you are an exporter or a inverted duty structure where the refunds are available. In no other case, the refunds are available for amounts which are stuck in your electronic credit ledger. I think this was all that was there from my side. I can now take up questions, if any, from any of you. Please put your questions in the chat window so that we can take up the questions. Okay, I think no questions. So no questions basically means either everything is understood or everything is not understood. Yes, there is one. Vikas Gundecha says he has already obtained an LUT prior to lockdown. We need to use for LUT for 1920 due to extensions, or we can quote LUT for 2021 for exports. So if you have already obtained an LUT for 2021, I think there's no problem. Please use the LUT of 2021. And this relief has been given for people who have not been able to obtain LUT. Of course, it's not very difficult. It's online. And in many cases, even after lockdown, we were able to obtain an LUT. But if you have not done that, you can use the 1920. In your example, you have already obtained. So please use 2021 only. The next question is from Aryan. At what point of time the documents for supply at 0.1% are to be filed with the GST officer? There's a very detailed notification, and Parth will email that notification to you, which lays down the detailed timelines and the scenarios within which the export has to be effected and the details which have to be done. Next question is from Saurabh. Can you elaborate on the documents required to be filed for an SEZ refund? The documents are similar to the normal refund scenario. Only important aspect which comes is there are two important additional documents which you need to bear in mind. You need to make sure that the SEZ unit has an approval from the development commissioner, and there's a specific document called a letter of approval and a letter of intent. Both those documents should be available to you. And secondly, if you are providing a service, in that case, the service which you are provided should be within the list of authorized operations as approved by the development commissioner. If you are supplying goods, then the invoice which is raised should bear an endorsement at the receiving office of the SEZ unit of the development commissioner. Those are the additional documents which are required in case of an SEZ refund claim. There's one question on YouTube chat, whether refund for capital goods is permissible. As I was highlighting, the law right now does not permit refunds for ITC relating to capital goods. It's a little bit of a unjust provision. There is a policy issue. I'm aware that people are filing writs in this regard. We will have to wait whether the courts intervene. But as of now, the law does not permit you to file a refund claim for input tax credit on in capital goods. The next question is from Vinod Lalwani. What is the time limit for receiving foreign currency against export of services from the foreign service recipient? It is as prescribed by the RBI. I understand it's generally 1 year. And then you can apply for an extension. The question is from Dhiren Ashar. Customs route or GST route can be selected for each consignment, or has to be selected at a registration level? The answer is it can be selected at each consignment level. It need not for one transaction, you can do something. For another, you can do something else. But our practical advice to clients is please choose one. Legally, there is no bar, but practically, you might trip on documentation at some place. And throughout my presentation, I have highlighted that documentation is the key in all of these scenarios. One more question which has come on YouTube is why unjust enrichment is not applicable to exports. There's a very specific subsection in 54 which says that the unjust enrichment will not apply to exports. And definitely that's a concession which has been given. Even under the excise regime, unjust enrichment principle was not applicable, and there were a lot of decisions. Under GST, though, there is a very specific subsection under 54 itself saying unjust enrichment does not apply to exports. Though it applies to SEZ supplies, it does not apply to an export. The next question is from an Aryan Kanda. A company is providing back office services to doctors in USA, like billing, filing, insurance claim, etc. Will it be considered as an export of service or an intermediary service? This has been a subject matter of a lot of debate and interpretation. What you have to look at is whether you are essentially in a nature of a call center or something. If you are a call center, then you are providing a service, an IT-enabled service on your own account. It is not an agency service provided to you, and therefore it will not constitute an intermediary service. However, you will have to look at the agreement and the terms of the contract and then take a final call. In case of doubt, you might like to email to us the agreement which you have with that foreign company for providing those back office services, so that we can revalidate your position which has been taken. The next question is from Anaga. In case of export of services under LUT, whether refund application needs to be matched with GSTR1 on a total basis or on an invoice basis, as statement 3 is based on GSTR1 and turnover of zero rated supply is calculated based on the amounts received as per FIRC during the relevant period. So essentially what you have to look at is a match. It has to be invoice as well as FIRC, and both the disclosures have to be there, and then only you will be eligible to claim the refund of the accumulated input tax credit. Therefore, typically it might be delayed by a few months. You might not be immediately able to file the refund application in case of export of services. Next question is from Dabolkar. If we fail to mention the LUT number in the export invoice and export is in the process or export is completed, what would be the impact of it? My belief is that if the shipping bill does not contain the LUT number and you have not chosen the option of export on payment of tax, you will not be permitted to export. Your consignment will get stuck at the customs level itself. There will be a query at the shipping bill stage itself. Now, if you have over there selected the option of against payment of tax, then there is a problem because the customs authorities will assume that you are paying the tax. And if in GSTR1 you do not show that, it will result in a lot of difficulty at a later stage. And therefore, in these types of cases, you have to be very, very careful. Next question is from Vikas Gundecha. Service engineers visit from India to a foreign country and execute services there. Will it amount to place of supply being outside India? I would believe so. It would be a place of supply outside India and it should constitute an export of service. Next question is from Aryan. A company in India providing services to an overseas company. Both companies are having a common shareholder. Whether it will be treated as a supply to a distinct person, it will not be treated as an ineligible supply. It will be treated as an export of service and you will be eligible for a benefit of exports. And I do not see there should be any problem on that. Next is export to Nepal in INR. Will it be treated as an export? I think there has been a concession over here and therefore you will be eligible for the zero rating in these types of scenarios. I think that is all that we have questions today. Thank you very much for a patient hearing. And tomorrow we will be having the session on conceptual topic of documentation and procedures. And thereafter the next week, we will be having sessions wherein we'll be going into the specific sectors and discussing the nuances of each of those specific sectors. Thank you very much for a patient hearing and stay safe. Thank you very much. I would